Andromeda Mysteries. Near the Andromeda galaxy, amateur astronomers have discovered a gigantic, enigmatic structure. The most intriguing aspect is that it was concealed in clear sight. No large telescope or observatory has observed it for decades. A backyard telescope was used to make the discovery, confirmed by professional astronomers. The Andromeda galaxy is approaching us at approximately 110 kilometers per second. It is headed for a collision with the Milky Way. In 5 billion years, the two enormous galaxies will collide. Since the galactic halos may already interact, astronomers believed it would result from a merger in its early phases. But carefully examining the structure reveals that things are more complicated than they appear. Never before has such a massive gas cloud been observed near a galaxy. So, what is the point? How did the large telescopes overlook it to begin with? Lastly, and most significantly, why have astronomers been unable to explain its origin up to this point? The closest giant galaxy to the Milky Way is Andromeda. Under perfectly dark skies, it is visible to the unaided eye. Astronomers' most favored galactic target due to its proximity. When amateur astronomers captured images of Andromeda, they discovered something unanticipated. Since Andromeda has been imaged multiple times by Earth-based observatories and even the Hubble Space Telescope, astronomers had assumed that the only remaining objects to detect within the galaxy would be small individual objects such as nebulae. However, the team observed something extremely unusual. They discovered a massive structure that appeared nearly as large as Andromeda itself. The only way to see the structure was through a special filter blocking all light except the blue-green luminescence emitted by doubly ionized oxygen. It refers to the light emitted by oxygen ions missing two outer electrons. They reported this discovery to expert astronomers. It was discovered that this emission characteristic had never been mentioned in scientific literature. Even multi-wavelength image surveys such as ROSAT for X-rays, GALAX for ultraviolet, Planck for IRAs and infrared, and SDSS for visible light had never reported such emissions from this structure. The astronomers also considered and denied the theory that the emission resulted from scattered light. Reflections on the self. Luminescence from image processing or detector amplifier indicates that they discovered something that no one had seen before. This discovery was strengthened by the observations of five telescopes in France, California, and New Mexico. Now the object bears the names of amateur astronomers Stratner-Dressler. ST-SDSO-1 or Object 1. Now that the existence of the structure has been confirmed, the crucial query is, what is it? Four possibilities have been examined by astronomers, but each has a problem. First, the structure may be associated with the galaxy due to its proximity to Andromeda. The cloud appears to gradually bulge away from the galaxy. Third, no solid evidence exists to substantiate its inclusion in the Andromeda galaxy. In this case, the cloud could be tens of thousands of light years long, making it one of the largest coherent structures in Andromeda. Consequently, if the cloud is located in the galactic halo, a roughly spherical collection of stars, it may be gas ejected by stellar winds. However, there should be a great deal of hydrogen in the universe, but observations have yet to detect any. Where then is the absent hydrogen that must be present? How did it form in the first place if it is not gas expelled by a stellar wind? As indicated at the beginning of the video, Andromeda and the Milky Way are on a collision course. They are only separated by 2.3 million light years. That's a short distance on the galactic inner scale. However, these two giants are so close together that their outer halos may have already begun interacting. As they travel through space, the two galaxies could collide. On collision, the diffuse gas in the two galactic halos would compress, forming a structure resembling the bow wave of a ship traveling through water. However, there is a problem with this hypothesis. If the cloud results from the intergalactic collision, it should not be so near Andromeda. Instead, it should appear midway between the two galaxies in the sky. In addition, this scenario does not account for the absence of hydrogen. SDS-01 is a component of the Milky Way and appears to be located close to Andromeda. Medium-sized stars that are fading release their outer layers as planetary nebula. The gas emitted by these stars contains a high hydrogen and oxygen concentration. The central star energizes the gas, and the planetary nebula is illuminated by the light emitted by both gas and starlight. However, the lack of hydrogen in this gas cloud contradicts this paradigm once more. Astronomers also contemplated the possibility that SDSO is the remnant of a star that exploded within the Milky Way. Then, however, it should emit ultraviolet and radio radiation. However, astronomers detected no other wavelengths emitting from the cloud, including X-rays, visible light, or infrared radiation. The true nature and origin of SDSO can only be determined once its spectrum is obtained. If the spectrum is blue and shifted to the same degree as Andromeda, the gas cloud is a part of the galaxy and is approaching at the same rate. But if it travels more slowly, it is likely within our galaxy. The faintness of the object necessitates extended exposure times. The discovery and confirmation of images using the doubly ionized oxygen filter requires 160 hours of observation. Professional observatories are designed differently than amateur telescopes for observing. When the 3.8-meter Canada-France-Hawaii telescope peered directly at that location, it did not detect anything. Although it is a fantastic telescope, it was not designed to detect such a large, dim object in the sky. The discovery of SDS-0 demonstrates that even though we have mapped the electromagnetic spectrum of the sky, there is still much to discover. Who would have imagined that a backyard telescope could discover something that not even the most sophisticated telescopes and observatories could see? Big explosions. Astronomers have recorded the most intense explosion in the universe to date. This gamma-ray eruption occurred 2 billion light-years away from the Earth. It was captured by an array of observatories located on and above the Earth. The event has already produced a treasure trove of scientific knowledge. The gamma-ray burst was so potent that it affected our atmosphere from a distance of 20,000 million 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 kilometers, and was bright enough to be seen through a smaller amateur telescope. However, what are gamma-ray bursts? What phenomenon is responsible for these enormous cosmic explosions? Why was this record-setting gamma-ray explosion so significant to astronomers? A gamma-ray burst, or GRB, is an intense gamma-ray explosion. It typically lasts a fraction of a second, and discharges as much energy as the Sun would in its 12 billion year existence. But where does this tremendous vitality come from? To comprehend this, let's examine gamma rays briefly. These are the most powerful electromagnetic radiation, or the light with the most energy. A single gamma ray photon could be significantly more potent than a photon of visible light. These photons are so densely packed with energy that they are a form of ionizing radiation, which can deprive an atom of its electrons, causing ionizations that can damage our tissues and DNA. Fortunately, the ozone layer safeguards us on Earth. It eliminates them before they can cause injury. So how were gamma-ray bursts initially detected if these powerful particles cannot reach the surface? The Cold War is the answer. The United States launched Vela satellites to detect gamma radiation pulses emitted by nuclear weapons tested in space during the 1960s. On July 2, 1967, Vela 4 and Vela 3 satellites detected a flare of gamma radiation unlike any nuclear weapon signature previously identified. Further analysis ruled out terrestrial or even solar origins for these enigmatic bursts. The first paper on gamma ray bursts and their cosmic origin was published 6 years later. Over 1,700 GRBs have been spotted, but it took decades to comprehend what they are and why they are so potent. Another difficulty is that the light curves of each GRB are distinct. This makes them difficult to comprehend as a group. However, they can be broadly categorized as short or lengthy GRBs. Typically, the short-duration blasts last a few seconds. They originated millions of years ago from two super-dense neutron stars compressed in a binary system. Their orbits decay as a result of gravitational wave-induced energy loss. Once they are near enough to touch, they release tremendous energy, forming a black hole. The long-duration burst lasts several minutes and is caused by massive stars exploding at the end of their lifetimes, forming more black holes. A disk of material not immediately consumed by the black hole quickly forms around it, funneling upward and downward pointing shafts of intense energy out into space and away from the disk. These consume the dying star and erupt outward as the remainder of the star erupts as a very powerful supernova. Gamma ray bursts derive their force from their sharp focus. These narrow beams concentrate explosive energy in an extremely narrow orientation. If the beam is directed at Earth, astronomers can detect a flash of gamma rays from billions of light years distant. A standard supernova is witnessed outside the path. A recent record-setting supernova is designated as GRB221009A. On October 9, 2022, the initial gamma ray emission was detected. The first flare in space was observed by the Fermi Gamma Ray Telescope. It's a 2008-launched space observatory designed to detect and swiftly pinpoint the location of GRBs. The Swift Observatory detected the second explosion of gamma rays an hour later. Swift sent an automated alert to astronomers around the globe, who responded by pointing their telescopes toward the explosion. This was an unusually lengthy gamma ray burst, indicating that it possessed enormous energy. The spectral analysis indicates that the GRB originated 2 billion light-years away in the direction of the constellation Sagittarius, due to the supernova of a massive star which terminated its existence and created a black hole. According to the quantity of energy released and the duration of the burst, astronomers estimate that the dying star was 30 times more massive than the Sun. It is the nearest and most powerful GRB ever recorded, with a distance of 2 billion light-years. Even our planet's atmosphere was affected. According to a tweet by astrophysicist Rami Mondo, lighting detectors in India and Germany revealed that pulses of electromagnetic radiation from light changed abruptly at the same moment the GRB energy struck Earth. These indicate that electrons altered the conditions in the Earth's upper atmosphere, immediately separated from their host atoms. Even though the change was mild and fleeting, it is a remarkable occurrence due to the vast distance between the Earth and the source of the GRB. This GRB is an exciting discovery for astrophysicists investigating cosmic phenomena with high energies. It will take months to become too faint to observe with telescopes, giving astronomers ample time to examine it. There is, however, a dilemma. At the end of November, GRB221009A will be so near to the Sun that astronomers will be unable to observe it through telescopes. Therefore, they have a brief opportunity to investigate the GRB's initial glow in multiple wavelengths before it disappears behind the Sun as seen from Earth. Astronomers can continue tracking its afterglow when GRB 221009A re-emerges from the opposite side of the Sun. First, limit the GRB's jet opening angle to determine its actual energy. Astronomers must still determine why this particular GRB is so bright, but they are confident that a multi-wavelength analysis will solve this conundrum. According to another theory, the most energetic planets may also be the birthplaces of some of the universe's heaviest elements. This gamma-ray burst functions as a laboratory unlike any other to test this theory. Astronomers want to determine whether supernovae can produce heavy elements such as gold, so they will measure the spectra of light emitted by material ejected by the supernova that produced this GRB. Astronomers are ecstatic because they may have observed history during this once-in-a-century explosion. Callisto imagery. Callisto, Jupiter's second-largest moon after Ganymede, is known throughout the solar system as one of the Jupiter Four. Callisto ranks third in diameter, following Ganymede and Saturn's largest moon, Triton. Callisto has the second-highest craters after Saturn's moon, Phoebe, among all celestial bodies in our solar system. The name Callisto was derived from the deity Callisto. Callisto is among the most potent Greek gods and Zeus's lover. The name Callisto means the most beautiful in Greek. According to legend, Callisto and her son Orcus were transformed into bears and carried to the stars. NASA's space probe photographs allow for a clearer view of the celestial bodies of our solar system. Callisto, along with Europa, Ganymede, and Io, was discovered. In 1610, Italian scholar Galileo Galilei discovered that Jupiter had three additional moons. In contrast to Galileo, who could only observe Callisto at a distance through his telescope, all four are called Galilean moons. Only Phoebe, a moon of Saturn, has a higher concentration of impact craters than Callisto. Due to the large number of craters on Callisto, each newly formed crater overlaps an older one. These factors are the most influential in shaping the environment. However, the impacts have also produced ring-shaped elevations on Callisto's surface. Finding higher mountain ranges or volcanoes in the lunar landscape is impossible. Due to the high percentage of ice and low percentage of rock on Callisto, scientists believe there are no planet elevations. However, craters and mountain ranges can form as ice crust gives way and levels. Throughout the solar system's existence, Callisto's surface has experienced essentially stable conditions. Therefore, the moon is geologically inactive, with no evidence of plate tectonics. Therefore, Callisto's geological evolution was simple and accomplished rapidly. Approximately 150 kilometers of ice cover the moon's surface, covered by a saltwater ocean 150 to 200 kilometers beneath. This assumption is founded on measurements collected by the Galileo spacecraft. In addition, the lack of fractures on the opposite side of the crater formed by the Earth's interior indicates the presence of an underground ocean. The shock vibrations generated by the liquid water have been absorbed by the moon of Earth following an impact. On the surface of the planet, fractures are discovered opposite the craters. On images of the moon Callisto, captured from a considerable distance, its entire surface displays areas of varying luminosity. In contrast to the filthy ice crust of Callisto, these regions have clearer ice. Structure inside. Like Neptune's moon Triton and Saturn's moon Titan, the interior structure of Callisto is comparable. Callisto is composed of 40% water ice and 60% silicate rock. As depth increases, the proportion of silicates increases. A minor amount of ammonia in the water increases the possibility of a subterranean ocean. The surface ice layer would be 300 kilometers thick without ammonia. Hydrostatic equilibrium suggests that Callisto's interior is composed of compressed rock and ice, according to the Galileo spacecraft. A compact silicate core can be identified by its density and moment of inertia at the center of Callisto. A nucleus of this type cannot have a radius greater than 600 kilometers. 2011 Galileo space probe observations indicate that the Moon is not in hydrostatic equilibrium. According to gravitational data collected by the spacecraft, this is true. Crater Heimdall is one of the most prominent impact craters on Callisto, the Moon of the Galilean system. Located near the South Pole, its diameter is 210 kilometers. The Voyager spacecraft initially discovered the crater and corroborated by images captured by the Galileo spacecraft, which depicted it as a bright spot. As a result, the International Astronomical Union approved the designation of Heimdall after the Nordic god of light in 2000. Callisto is Jupiter's satellite. Linde joins craters roster. The Linde crater is the third most important impact crater on the Moon. Lafun is a relatively juvenile 1,000-kilometer-wide impact crater in the southern hemisphere. Approximately 30% of AD Linde is covered by deposits, rendering it impossible to conduct a detailed investigation. AD Linde's ring-shaped crater is scarcely discernible in photographs. The crater's appellation derives from Inuit mythology. The 1,600-kilometer diameter Asgard crater. The Asgard crater is the second largest annular impact crater on Jupiter's moon Callisto. Asgard appears in images as a brilliant dot surrounded by concentric circles. In its northern portion, the 600-kilometer-long Edgard crater rests on top of the domed shape DOE, which is then covered by the Asgard crater. Bright areas in the images indicate the presence of additional impact craters nearby. BR crater is located above Turner-Suk crater, which is located to the right. The Omo crater is situated directly above the Turner crater. Below Turner crater is the Nord crater. Also named after Nordic mythology is Asgard. A family of Asian deities resides in Asgard. Crater Valhalla, the most significant impact crater in our solar system, is visible on Jupiter's moon Callisto. In addition to the concentric circles encircling the crater's formation, the 360-kilometer inner crater is particularly striking. The crater's diameter is 3,800 kilometers. The Voyager spacecraft discovered the impact crater slightly above Jupiter's equator in a quadrant confronting Jupiter in 1979. It is believed that cooled granite formed the ring system surrounding the crater. In the crater of Valhalla, three geological zones are discernible. The inner zone, which has a diameter of 360 kilometers, creates the impact point. Here is where the surface is relatively uniform and spotted. The protruding boulder and surrounding plains are visible in the high-resolution images captured by the Galileo spacecraft. The rock is depicted as dark, as are the plains, and the interior region is surrounded by ridges and depressions. These mountain ridges have precipitous flanks that extend from the interior to the exterior. Light-colored cliffs are surrounded by dark material. The high-resolution images captured by Galileo can only cast light on the structure of the Valhalla impact crater. This region has a lot of rugged terrain. The depressions further from the crater center are surrounded by 20-kilometer-wide winding mountain ridges. The center of Valhalla crater is 950 kilometers away from this region. There is a trough zone with a radius between 1,500 and 1,900 kilometers. There are 30 kilometers wide winding granite formations in the interior zone. the Voyager and Galileo spacecraft have not detected any volcanic activity in this region or in images of limited resolution. Are volcanic flows detectable? All structures within the crater of Valhalla are either tectonic or impact formed. The Valhalla crater was formed by a massive impact. The object penetrated the exterior lithosphere as well as the material beneath it. According to the data, it might have been ice or an ocean. The impact fractured Callisto's crust, allowing ice or water to flow into the fissures. Since its formation, approximately 2 to 4 billion years have passed. Valhalla, also known as the Hall of Warriors in Nordic mythology, is the ultimate resting place of valiant warriors. A swimming facility in G. This pool is Catena G's. Catena craters cover 620 kilometers on Jupiter's moon Callisto. The enormous crater has a diameter of 40 kilometers. The crater formation on Callisto is the longest of all similar formations. The crater chain was created when an object fragmented during Jupiter's close approach. Ceres planet mysteries. We greatly understand our solar system, but what else do we know? The system contains 8 planets, a star, and several objects that are not visible to the unaided eye. However, what are the nature of their resources? Our focus should be shifted to something nearby. A third of a dwarf planet's mass can be found within an asteroid belt. Ceres is the second most minor dwarf planet in the solar system after Haia. Previously, the most minor dwarf planet in our solar system was deemed the smallest. Ceres was discovered by the Italian astronomer Giuseppe Piazzi in 1801, and it has been considered a full-fledged planet of our solar system ever since. This celestial body, with a diameter of approximately 950 kilometers, was classified as a dwarf planet in 2006. Ceres is the most colossal asteroid in the asteroid belt. Many satellites of other planets are smaller than a massive planet satellite. Enceladus, for example, has a diameter of 504 kilometers, making it twice as large. On the other hand, Ceres account for almost 32% of the asteroid belt's mass. Consequently, it was feasible to determine the object's effect on the smaller objects in the belt. Using the average of the 3 most accurate estimates made as of 2008, the mass of Ceres is 1.3% of the Moon's mass. Even though the Ceres is 3.5 times smaller than the Moon, the disparity between their masses is remarkable. This is because their chemical compositions differ, as the Moon primarily comprises igneous rocks. Ceres has a spherical shape, which is unusual for minor celestial bodies. It assumed this form due to the gravitational force exerted by its own mass. Unlike massive asteroids such as Pallas or Juno, are not spherical. The object encompasses 2,849,631 square kilometers. Comparatively, it is larger than Argentina. The absence of asteroids on Ceres is its distinguishing feature. After the object acquired a spherical shape, gravitational differentiation began within its interior. In summary, heavier rocks migrate to the planet's center, while lighter rocks form the crust. As a result, Ceres now possesses a rocky nucleus and a chromium-coated mantle of water ice. The 100-kilometer-thick mantle comprises roughly 23-28% of the object's mass, and 50% of its volume. In addition, it contains more ice than fresh water on Earth. According to the theory, Ceres's interior was initially heated by radioactive decay during the asteroid's formation. In addition, it is possible that some portions of the frigid mantle were liquid at the time. Regarding cryovolcanism on Ceres, this remains an open matter. The Dawn instrument gathered and analyzed data. A substantial quantity of ice or frigid surface regolith covers the surface. The highest mountain on Ceres, Ahuna Mons, is a cryovolcano. Before 1 billion years ago, the dwarf planet exhibited geological activity. Ceres may be active now, for all we know from Earth's vantage point. On Ceres, there is a faint disk that is barely visible. The Hubble Space Telescope could only discern finer details at the end of the 20th century. The surface of the asteroid appears to have both dark and bright patches. Piazzi, the brightest star, is the most popular. This location depicts a volcano spewing icy mantles from its caldera. Observations using infrared light revealed the object's average surface temperature to be 167 degrees Kelvin, or 160 degrees Celsius below absolute zero. Observations of the dwarf planet and radio spectrum revealed Ceres's surface was relatively smooth. The icy mantle should be expected to be elastic, so this is not unexpected. Before 2015, Ceres was only studied through telescopic observation. After drifting in investors' orbits, the Dawn Interplanetary Space Probe was launched in 2007, signifying the most significant stage in studying the dwarf planet. In January 2014, the Herschel Infrared Space Telescope detected water vapor plumes surrounding the object. Consequently, Ceres became the fourth celestial body in the solar system to possess water activity. Additionally, we possess Enceladus, Europa, and our own planet. The Dawn mission was introduced to Ceres on January 13, 2015, when it captured the first detailed images of the planet. The date was February the 8th. A speed probe traveling 360 km per hour was only 118,000 km from the object. Two bright white spots are plainly visible on the dwarf planet in images published by NASA on February the 18th and February the 25th. Carbonate of sodium, or soda, was subsequently determined to be the chemical element responsible for the spots. Dawn entered the asteroid's orbit on March the 6th and will continue observations for 16 months. During this time, a photograph was taken of a perplexing broad spot. The photographs we have of them continue to be the finest available. On June 30, 2016, the probe's mission concluded. It also provided conclusive evidence that water ice exists on the dwarf planet's surface, based on data transmitted back to Earth. The northern polar region of Ceres contains 10 craters with brilliant deposits. A spectroscopic examination of one of them revealed the formation of ice. The 2015 spectrum revealed no water, only hydroxyl-rich substances and fainter ammonium traces. It is presumably a clay containing hydroxyls and ammonia. Due to the smaller-than-anticipated number of major craters, it was possible to draw certain conclusions about them using Dawn probe data. After completing all studies, if the surface endures gradual changes is reasonable. The water vapor on Ceres is estimated to be between 20 and 30%. In addition, numerous hydrous minerals and substances, carbonates and iron-rich clays are on the surface. On Ceres, no moons are known to exist. With the Hubble telescope, observations were made. Moons, if they exist, cannot be larger than 20 kilometers in diameter. The study of this space object continues regardless. In the upcoming decade, the Chinese National Space Administration will collect a sediment sample from the dwarf planet's surface. A series of asteroids are frequently affiliated with other large objects. This celestial body, Vesta, is the largest and heaviest asteroid known to science. Vesta is visible to the unaided eye from our planet's surface. It is 578 by 560 by 458 kilometers in size. According to the revised classification of solar system objects, if it were not so asymmetrical, it would also qualify as a dwarf planet. Vesta, Pallas, and other massive asteroids have half the mass of Ceres. The surface temperatures of Vesta fluctuate between 106 and minus 3 degrees Celsius. In addition, Vesta is 25% heavier than a Pallas. The Curiosity Mars rover captured an image of Vesta and Ceres in 2014. Several decades ago, scientists presented a formidable challenge to an object like Ceres. However, this object's composition, chemical structure, and formation history are now known with certainty. Europa discoveries. Europa is one of the most fascinating satellites in our solar system. The universe is full of mysteries and splendor. The image of Europa captured by the Pioneer probe in 1973 was the first ever close-up of this planet. Voyager and Galileo spacecraft have since explored the Moon whenever they visit. However, Europa has always satisfied us. Though many mysteries remain, we are beginning to piece together many aspects of Europa. Europa's position within the Jovian system is the first item we must comprehend. Europa, with an approximate diameter of 3,000 kilometers, is the second smallest of the four Galilean moons and the sixth largest in the solar system. Jupiter's orbit requires more than 3.5 days. This is due to the slightly elliptical orbit of Europa. The first three Galilean moons, Io, Europa, and Ganymede, are bound in a 4-to-1 orbital resonance due to their mutual gravitational pull. In other terms, Ganymede orbits Jupiter twice, Europa and Io four times. The other moon's constant gravitational pull precludes Europa's orbit from becoming perfectly circular. Throughout its orbit around Jupiter, the gravitational force operating upon it fluctuates. In turn, this causes the moon's tides to extend its surface. These forces profoundly influence the moon's appearance and what occurs beneath its surface. Europa's surface is covered with a vast amount of water ice. Like ocean ridges on Earth, as the crust separates due to tidal flexing, warmer material from below fills the crevices as they form. These lengthy, continuous fractures and fissures are notable and distinctive. Lines in Latin are known as linear. These linear are typically only 1 to 2 kilometers wide, but they can span thousands of kilometers across the Moon's surface. This image captured by Galileo reveals several dark brown blotches. Less than 10 kilometers in diameter, they are known as lenticular clouds. In addition, they may be caused by the upwelling of hot, less dense material to the surface, either by forcing the existing crust upward or by penetrating it. What would have transpired if the confidential information had leaked? As a result, these odd and unusual terrains, known as chaos terrains, are visible. The surfaces are relatively clean, except for a few rough spots. These spots may contain valuable information about what resides beneath Europa's surface. Galileo's data also suggested that the equator of Europa may be covered with ice peaks known as penitents. The equator has probable 15-meter-tall vertical fissures caused by direct overhead sunlight. Intriguingly, penitents are also present on Earth, albeit in smaller numbers than on Europa. Although Europa is as old as the solar system, its surface has almost no craters. Europa has fewer than 50 significant craters with diameters greater than 25 kilometers, compared to the Moon of Earth. The surface of Europa is constantly undergoing reformation and modification. According to models, Europa's surface is only 30 to 180 million years old, which is geologically very youthful. No celestial body in the solar system has a smoother surface than Europa's ice surface. Its icy covering has one of the highest albedos of all moons, with a reflectivity of 0.64. This contributes to the fivefold brilliance of Europa. constant and intense radiation from Jupiter bombards the surface of the planet. About 5,400 millisieverts of radiation are emitted daily from Europa's surface. If exposed to that level of radiation, humans would perish in one day. Salt and sulfur compounds are believed to be responsible for the reddish-brown hue of the moon's fissures and crevices. Jupiter's radiation modifies water ice after it has interacted with it. A recent JPL investigation suggests that Europa may emit light at night. Radiation's energetic ions penetrate the surface, energizing the molecules beneath and releasing energy as visible light. Constantly positioned between Europa and the Sun, we cannot observe its negative side. Future missions to Europa will be required to verify this. Radiation from Jupiter also plays a significant influence on Europa's atmosphere. The predominant component of Europa's atmosphere is oxygen. On Europa, water ice is separated into hydrogen and oxygen by a radiolysis process, which differs from the process on Earth. Hydrogen is so light that it completely escapes Europa's gravity, while molecular oxygen remains in a cloud that follows Europa's orbit around Jupiter. According to the Hubble Space Telescope, plumes of water vapor emanate from Pluto's south pole. This image depicts water columns 200 kilometers above the Earth's surface. In 2018, an analysis of old Galileo data revealed additional evidence of plume activity on Europa. The mission's commitment to the cause. We can also learn about the moon's interior without landing by analyzing these plumes. Europa is intriguing due to the possibility of what lies beneath its solid icy surface. A global ocean between the stony mantle and the water ice crust may exist. In 1979 and the late 1990s, the Voyager and Galileo spacecraft revealed that a fantastic world lies beneath the ocean's surface for the first time. A dramatic change in the moon's magnetic field occurred between these missions, which is unthinkable without electrically conductive fluid beneath its surface. Furthermore, Europa's crust rotates at an angle of 80 degrees, which would be impossible if the crust and stony mantle were mechanically connected. Therefore, it is more plausible that the icy crust floats on the ocean and revolves around the moon once every 12,000 years. This ocean's linea are also explained by the fact that they are not attached to anything. Linea is anticipated to form at specific locations on Europa due to tidal deformation. Instead, it is limited to a few locations. Despite this, one spot remains in a distinct location for an extended period as the crust's position shifts. Consequently, linear forms are becoming increasingly prevalent. Europa is 5 times further from the planet than Earth, at 780 million kilometers. Due to this, there is approximately 25 times less sunlight there. Europa and any other moon in the Jovian system are scarcely warmed by the sun. As a consequence of the cold weather, the surface is frozen here. The average surface temperature of Europa is 160 degrees Celsius at the equator and minus 220 degrees Celsius at the poles, maintaining Europa's ice crust made of granite. Jupiter's tidal forces heat Europa's interior as the planet orbits the Moon. Due to geothermal activity from the interior, subsurface oceans should remain liquid. The ocean's solid ice crust is only 15 to 25 kilometers thick. Ocean depths vary between 60 and 150 kilometers. Despite its relatively modest size, Europa may contain twice as much water as all of Earth's oceans combined. In addition, scientists believe Europa's ocean is in contact with the planet's silicate-rich stony mantle, which is one of the planet's most intriguing features. Due to these factors, life as we know it is possible in Europa's ocean. life requires water, minerals, and energy to exist on Europa. This is the case based on the evidence we've seen thus far. There may be geothermal activity on the ocean floor, similar to what we have observed on Earth, due to sufficient tidal energy to heat the core and chemical reactions. Even at great distances from the Sun, entire ecosystems can exist. Therefore, Europa is one of the most probable places to find life beyond Earth at this time. Europa Clipper is expected to launch in 2022 and reach the Moon by the decade's end. It will fly over Europa more than 42 times. In addition, it is constructing its own spacecraft, Jupiter Icy Moons Explorer, which will explore Jupiter and its three largest moons, Ganymede, Callisto, and Europa. It is anticipated that the 2022 launch JUICE will reach the Moon by the end of the decade. The sensors are designed to investigate Europa's water plumes and atmosphere. NASA intends to launch Europa Lander well after Europa Clipper. These missions will provide additional information about Europa and answer the most intriguing query: does it have the ability to support life? These missions will provide a fresh perspective on our solar system, enhancing our comprehension. Neptune's strange activity. Lying 4.5 billion kilometers distant, Neptune is the solar system's most distant and least explored planet. Voyager 2 is the only spacecraft to have ever visited a distant planet, and it did so in 1989 during a flyby. Therefore, there are numerous things we must understand about this ice giant. In addition, very few modern telescopes on Earth can conduct detailed observations of this planet. Since 2003, 17 years of data indicate something strange has occurred on Neptune. The axial inclination of Neptune is 28.32 degrees, similar to Earth's. Therefore, Neptune experiences similar seasonal variations to Earth. However, because it is so distant in the solar system, it takes 165 Earth years to complete one orbit around the Sun. This indicates that each season on Neptune is 4 decades long. The southern hemisphere of the planet is experiencing an epic 40-year-long summer. But according to a recent study published in the Planetary Science Journal by the American Astronomical Society, it is odd that the temperature is not rising in that region of the planet. In contrast, the opposite is occurring there. Since the beginning of summer, the average temperature has dropped 8 degrees Celsius. In 2005, summer began in the southern hemisphere of Neptune. Since the researchers combined data from 2003 to 2020, they have been observing the planet since the start of the season. The stratosphere of Neptune unexpectedly chilled down between 2003 and 2009. After analyzing over a century's thermal infrared images of Neptune captured over 17 years, the researchers made this discovery. 6 major telescopes contributed to this investigation, but the European Southern Observatory's Very Large Telescope, or VLT, played the most significant role. VLT is a ground-based telescope that can photograph Neptune at the same level as the Hubble Space Telescope, as demonstrated in this image. The other observatories included the Gemini North Telescope, the Gemini South Telescope, the Subaru Telescope, and the Keck Observatory. Vizier, the VLT imager and mid-infrared spectrometer, was the study's most powerful instrument. It was installed on a very large telescope. This device can determine the temperature based on the amount of infrared radiation emitted. The decrease in temperature from 2003 to 2018 is the beginning of the southern hemisphere. However, summers were not the only unexpected occurrence. Between 2018 and 2020, the temperature increased by 11 degrees C. Now, you might assume it's acceptable that summer temperatures are high, But the intriguing thing is that Neptune has 40-year-long summers, so one would expect gradual changes. Given the limited data on the atmospheric conditions of this remote ice colossus, the sudden increase in temperature after a mysterious drop in the first few years of the season is puzzling. We only partially understand why Neptune's temperature fluctuates so dramatically, but astronomers have proposed some intriguing theories to explain this anomaly. They believe that the local chemistry of the planet is responsible for this phenomenon. Neptune has a dynamic atmosphere composed of 80% hydrogen, 19% helium, and trace quantities of methane, despite being the most distant giant planet from the Sun. While methane absorbs sunlight and warms the atmosphere, photochemically produced hydrocarbons, such as ethane and acetylene, are potent infrared emitters that chill the stratosphere. As the quantity of photochemical hydrocarbons varies, so does the equilibrium between radiative heating and cooling. Astronomers have observed a similar phenomenon in the solar system. Previous research on Saturn's temperature revealed, for instance, that the interaction of chemicals in the atmospheric clouds can influence their temperature, causing temperature peaks before maximum solar irradiation. And something comparable may be occurring here. However, due to Neptune's 165-year orbit, these changes are expected to occur gradually as the season progresses. The rapid increase in temperature between 2018 and 2020 suggests that there may be different processes operating in Neptune's atmosphere on sub-seasonal, regional, and global timescales. It is also plausible that Neptune's extreme weather is responsible for this trend in abnormal temperature. Winds on Neptune are the quickest in the solar system. On this planet, wind velocities can exceed 1,900 kilometers or 1,200 miles per hour. These winds propel blizzards of frozen methane through the planet's atmosphere, potentially influencing the temperature. Additionally, Neptune has frequent and enormous storms. In 1989, Voyager 2 detected a massive cyclone known as the Great Dark Spot near the planet's south pole. At its peak, the cyclone was larger than Earth, but vanished when the Hubble Space Telescope observed Neptune in the 1990s. Finally, the researchers also conducted the investigation. If the 11-year solar cycle is responsible for the temperature fluctuations on Neptune, then the Sun's magnetic field reverses direction every 11 years. This alters solar radiation levels, which physicists can deduce from the surface number of sunspots. In addition, there is a correlation between the variations in temperature and the number of sunspots on the Sun over time. Nonetheless, the relationship between the two must be strengthened for this idea to be conclusively supported. According to the new study, regardless of the reason for Neptune's temperature fluctuations, it was fortunate that this particular trend was discovered and published just before the launch of the iconic James Webb Telescope. About 6% of Webb's Cycle 1 observation time has been devoted to the solar system. Webb is an infrared observatory and the ideal instrument for investigating Neptune's summer enigma in greater detail. Obviously, the only way to study the planet in great detail over time is to dispatch a probe that orbits Neptune, similar to Juno and Cassini for Jupiter and Saturn, respectively. However, this option is eliminated for the next 10 years. NASA has recently proposed dispatching a probe to Uranus as a top research priority. Concerning Neptune, however, we must continue to research the planet using telescopes on and around Earth, and the planet's summer mystery remains unsolved. Sun's activity. In the future years, the Sun will likely cause significant problems on Earth as it enters the most intense phase of its cycle. Electrical blackouts, power interruptions, and communication satellite disturbances have occurred for months. Watch the video until the end if you need to learn about the solar cycle and how it affects space weather. The Sun appears as a bright sphere of light across the sky from Earth. However, the Sun is the most dynamic object in the solar system when viewed up close. The Sun is analogous to a gigantic magnet, but more complex. The Sun's magnetic field reverses direction every 11 years, with the north becoming the south and the south becoming the north. After another 11 years, the poles reverse. This 11-year cycle is commonly referred to as the solar cycle. As the poles rotate, the Sun experiences maximum and minimum activity periods. For example, when the Sun entered its 25th cycle in 2020, it was at solar minimum. Consequently, as the Sun awakens from its dormancy, storms will ensue. Here, the storms are not like those on Earth, but rather powerful solar storms that can throw our existence into chaos. In the years leading up to July 2025, the Sun's activity will increase and solar storms will reach their apex. However, what exactly are these solar disturbances that are causing us concern? Our internet connection, also called a coronal mass ejection or CME, is currently down. A solar storm is an intense solar outburst of charged particles. These particles can travel several million kilometers per hour and take anywhere between 13 hours and 5 days to reach Earth. Even though the Earth's atmosphere shields us from these particles, they can overwhelm the atmosphere if they occur in sufficient quantities. In addition, the solar storm's charged particles can generate their own magnetic fields. Eventually, they can interact with the Earth's magnetic field, introducing powerful electric currents at the surface. This alters the Earth's magnetic field, affecting the accuracy of compasses and other artificial structures, such as communication channels. However, how do we know that solar cyclones pose a risk to our communication channels? Do we have any supporting evidence? Have we seen anything similar before? Unfortunately, the answer is yes. In 1859, the Carrington event, the most intense solar storm, reached Earth in approximately 17 hours. It caused compasses to malfunction worldwide, wreaking havoc on the telegraph network, and many operators even received electric shocks. In addition, the Northern Lights, also known as the Aurora Borealis, were spotted in Colombia, which lies near the equator. In 1921, a solar tempest again affected the New York telegraph and railway systems. You may wonder, if the Sun follows this pattern every 11 years and we have witnessed similar events in the past, why should we be concerned now? There is a clear distinction between past events and potential future events. In the past, technology and communication channels were restricted. They did not completely control our existence. In contrast, our reliance on technology has skyrocketed over the past decade, making the upcoming cycle critical for us. So much is known about the current infrastructure's ability to withstand a potent solar storm. In addition to all the speculation, a 2013 report stated that if a solar storm similar to the one that occurred in 1859 struck the United States today, 20 to 40 million people would be without power for 1 to 2 years, and the total economic cost would be between 0.6 and 2.6 trillion. This situation causes us concern. According to the new study, the likelihood of a catastrophic solar storm occurring within the next decade ranges from 1.6% to 13%. And if such a solar storm were to strike the Earth, it would be powerful enough to cause catastrophic disruption. It would cause significant damage to the internet infrastructure of the planet and influence power grids worldwide. However, it would severely damage the repeaters utilized for signal amplification in long-distance fiber-optic cables. We have a general comprehension of how these storms will impact terrestrial power grids. However, predicting their impact on subsea cables connecting continents is even more difficult. Internet connectivity has been designed to reroute the network if one path fails, but at the expense of performance. However, experts believe a significant outage could render most grids inoperable, limiting the Internet's ability to establish the necessary link. Do you believe that the world could endure a global Internet outage? Share your opinions in the comments section. The Pluto Enigma. 2015 was a year of tremendous enthusiasm for the space community. Before that, we had only this image of Pluto's system. Pluto is so small and far away that even Hubble could only detect a few flecks of color variation when it focused its lens on the planet. In 2015, however, everything changed. Thanks to the New Horizons spacecraft, which flew by Pluto 9 years after its launch, we could see Pluto and its moons with unprecedented clarity and precision. What did the New Horizons spacecraft observe during its Pluto system flyby? Pluto was the 10th planet to be investigated after 9 traditional planets. Because of our separation, this occurred. As a celestial object, it elicited no fascination. New Horizons was launched in 2006 as part of NASA's New Frontiers program for medium-budget space missions, due to the efforts of the New Horizons team. New Horizons' launch was the quickest ever, because it was designed to reach Pluto quickly. This lightweight spacecraft is atop the Atlas V, the world's most powerful rocket. In just 9 hours, it surpassed the Moon. The journey of Apollo to Pluto took 10 times as long. However, the arrival time was shortened by 3 years thanks to Jupiter's gravity assist. In addition to testing its systems on Jupiter, the spacecraft captured superb images and videos of the planet and its satellites. Before its approach in 2015, New Horizons entered hibernation mode to protect its instruments from wear and tear. After the crew brought the systems back online, images from the spacecraft were transmitted daily. At this time, there was a great deal of excitement among aficionados. After reading the narrative, we could visualize Pluto's possible appearance and distinguish it from Charon, Pluto's enormous moon. With a higher resolution, more details could be captured. Although the mission had other scientific objectives, I was most intrigued by what I saw. On the dwarf planet, a shape resembling a heart could be seen. On July the 14th, the New Horizons spacecraft made its closest approach to Pluto, only 12,500 kilometers distant. However, mission controllers were unable to detect it promptly. During the flypast, the probe was too busy taking photographs to transmit data promptly. The uplink pace was 1 kilobit per second once data transfer began. In addition, the distance between the spacecraft and Earth was 4.5 hours. Despite this, the returned images and videos were magnificent. Mountains, glaciers, and icy plains. In addition to Pluto's moons, it examined them closely. Now let's examine the findings from this flypast. The peculiar relationship between Pluto and its moons was one of the first items discovered about the planet. Charon was the first thing I considered when considering Pluto's enormous moon. They are also significant relative to Pluto's orbits. Both objects or centers of mass are located outside the principal object. However, there is a point in space where both of them orbit. In addition, the two objects are tidally bound together. If you stand on one, the other cannot be moved. It is uncommon that the moon is not tidally locked to its parent planet, as many moons are. Charon's hue is significantly darker than Pluto's, allowing it to stand out visually. In other words, they originated elsewhere. Pluto's moons are minuscule, with diameters of less than a kilometer. Pluto's geology is a topic of significant interest. Pluto's most prominent visible feature is this enormous heart-shaped formation, which initially astounded the world. The Sputnik Planitia has been named in its honor. These objects have exceptionally circular orbits compared to Pluto. The color contrast between the neighboring area and the size of Texas is striking. This is because it is a massive ice aircraft. The composition of 98% of Pluto's nitrogen ice was confirmed during the flyby. The average surface temperature of Pluto is minus 229 degrees Celsius, which renders water ice unyielding and brittle. When nitrogen ice reaches this temperature, it behaves similarly to water ice on Earth, forming glaciers. The heart's edge is particularly susceptible to this. A glacier flows into a crater or mountain ridge's crevice. On the entirety of the ice plains, enormous polygons are visible. The presence of ridges on polygonal cells indicates sublimation. In addition, there are no craters, indicating that this feature is relatively recent. It has only been 10 million years since its formation. It is known that ice transforms into a gas, but the process is unknown. The liquid ocean's subsurface has been filled with a block of ice. Sputnik Planitia could have been formed by an impact. This filled-in basin is responsible for a positive gravitational anomaly. A gravitational anomaly occurs when gravity at one point differs from gravity at another. Charon is aligned with the ice plane's tidal axis by facing away from it. This is owing to the close proximity of Pluto and Charon. Both objects are influenced by tides. Perhaps this is why Pluto and Charon are tidally bound and unable to break eye contact. The ice plains are surrounded by colossal water ice mountain ranges that appear magnificent. Water ice is the only type on Pluto that can sustain heights of several kilometers at this temperature. Pluto's mountains may also contain cryovolcanoes, with one of the most probable candidates being correct. There is a substantial depression at the peak center, making it one of Pluto's tallest mountains. Cryovolcanoes may be responsible for Pluto's youthful surface. There appears to be some dark material scattered across Pluto's surface. The Cthulhu Macula is the most significant of these regions. The image is reminiscent of a well. The dark color is believed to result from sunlight reacting with hydrocarbons to form tholins. One of Saturn's moons, Iapetus, has similar deposits. The exact process has been observed in other solar system regions. Pluto's region is significantly more cratered than the cottage, indicating its surface. Amid the macula, a much older mountain range is visible, capped with methane ice. At Pluto's upper altitudes, methane appears to condense as frost. Tartarus dorsa is the final surface feature I will discuss in this article. This extensive, extremely distinctive group of mountains consists of 500-meter-tall peaks that resemble snakeskin or tree bark. They are believed to be penitents. Only one observation of Pluto has been made in the solar system. They are extremely uncommon even on Earth. Some inhabit the Atacama Desert and other arid high-altitude regions. Pluto has much greater mountains and a much larger surface area than Earth. Therefore, it is impossible to get near to them. New Horizons has verified that Pluto's atmosphere is the most remarkable discovery. In addition, Pluto's diminutive size and feeble gravity makes the images even more remarkable. It appears that Pluto has a thick atmosphere. Because Earth's gravity is considerably stronger than Pluto's, its atmosphere envelops the planet more securely, as it is more massive and dense. However, Pluto possesses a thin atmosphere. 10 microbots exert a 1 million times weaker pressure than Earth's surface pressure. The pressure could increase from 18 to 280 millibars, approximately three times the surface pressure on Mars, and one-fourth the surface pressure on Earth. If Pluto's surface ices were to dissolve and sublimate into gases, as observed on the ice plains, then the last time Pluto had this atmospheric density was 900,000 years ago, when temperatures were high. At these temperatures and pressures, liquid nitrogen could form on Pluto's surface. A frozen lake may substantiate this claim within at least 1 year. Seasonally, Pluto's atmospheric density can fluctuate by a factor of 4. Other objects in the solar system have relatively stable atmospheres, which is a stark contrast. Additionally, surface-located condensed ice contributes to the atmosphere. The discovery by New Horizons that the atmosphere has up to 20 haze layers was intriguing. The presence of haze layers was anticipated, but their quantity was unexpected. These layers of fog are visible in some of these photographs. This photograph depicts such a layer, as sunlight can flow through it. In contrast to the sunlight streaming through the haze, the mountain shadows are distinctly visible. There is no global leveling of the planet's strata. A layer of haze can be observed high above the ground. On the other hand, it reaches the surface on this side. Other than that, these are some of the most significant Pluto photographs I've ever seen. Seeing mountain ranges allows one to appreciate their magnitude and depth. Pluto resembles a toy planet due to its extreme topographic relief. But these mountains are so tall because Pluto's gravity is too weak to draw them down. Triton and Neptune. As with most moons, Triton and Neptune have a synchronous rotation. Due to its orbital speed and rotation, one side of the moon always confronts the planet, while the other permanently faces space. It is the only major moon in the solar system with a retrograde orbit, meaning it orbits in the opposite direction of its parent planet. This peculiar orientation sheds light on Triton's origins. If Triton was a moon of Neptune, then Neptune and its moons would orbit in the same direction if Triton was formed from a cloud of compressing gas at the same time as Neptune. In addition to all other major moons, seven so-called regular moons of Neptune orbit in the same direction as the planet along its orbital disk. Unlike these interior satellites, Triton orbits at an unusual angle and is much farther from the orbital disk than these inner satellites. Triton cannot be regarded as a Neptune moon in this sense. Now, scientists believe Triton formed in the Kuiper Belt, an orbital rim of icy material left over from the formation of our solar system beyond Neptune's orbit. More than 50 astronomical units separate the Sun's orbit from Neptune's. A 50-fold difference in distance exists. Even at the edge of the Kuiper Belt, there is mounting evidence that the Earth orbits the Sun. Pluto is the Moon's estranged sibling. Due to its reclassification as a dwarf planet, Pluto is the most well-known Kuiper Belt object. However, other planets exist beside Pluto. In the Kuiper Belt, thousands of dwarf and minor planets are forming and being destroyed by trillions of ice, ammonia, and rock fragments. It is now believed that Triton is formed similarly, as it is only one-fifth the size of Pluto and has strikingly similar compositions. Pluto may have formed under identical circumstances if it is composed of the same material. Triton was born in the Kuiper Belt, so how did it become a moon of Neptune? Triton's formation in the Kuiper Belt would have brought it close to Neptune's orbit during its passage through the solar system's outer regions. Typically, minor planets move too quickly to be captured by a large planet's gravity. Consequently, something must have slowed the young planet as it approached the orbit of the icy giant. Triton's loss of momentum was likely caused by a collision with another dwarf planet or a moon of Neptune. In addition, it may have formed as a dwarf planet with a small moon, which would have been dislodged by Neptune's gravity, further reducing its velocity as it approached the massive planet. Regardless of the impact's effectiveness, Triton would have been deemed powerless as it was sucked into Neptune's orbit. As observed by the Voyager spacecraft, its orbit around Neptune would not have been circular. This would have caused a chaotic, highly eccentric elliptical orbit that would have significantly impacted the dwarf planet that was displaced into the Neptunian system. Because of friction, heat, and convection, Triton has unique characteristics for a moon. As the moon orbits a giant planet, the gravitational influence of the parent planet fluctuates as the distance between the planet and the satellite varies. Therefore, friction is created within the interior. Tidal heating occurs when the moon's interior is heated by the planet's gravity squashing and bending it. Only three moons in our solar system are geologically active, including Jupiter's Io, which is also active due to tides. Planets' interiors can be decimated by their parent planet's gravitational forces. It is uncommon for a granite satellite to orbit a planet, but Io is considerably more active than Triton. The inner materials of the new surrogate moon of Neptune would have burst through surface faults due to tidal heating, resulting in the rocky terrain continuously reshaped by active geysers. Despite being billions of kilometers from the Sun, Triton is still considered a hotbed of geological activity, even though the moon's tidal heating effect is no longer a constant force. This discovery disproved the theory that only frigid, silent planets could exist so far from the Sun. Due to Triton's capture by Neptune, fewer moons are orbiting Neptune than anticipated, and Neptune's second moon has an unusual orbit. Computer simulations indicate that Triton's initial collision caused subsequent collisions between other moons. Thus, while those moons lost Triton 1, it began life as an orphan destined to wander aimlessly through the solar system's outer reaches before being adopted by Neptune, where it now orbits. Triton is therefore an offspring of Neptune, albeit an exceptional one. However, had its fate been different, it would have remained a dwarf planet within the Kuiper Belt. Numerous small suspended objects, such as Pluto, Sedna, and Eris, exist in this vast frozen world. There are some distinct qualities to Triton, a distant moon. Humanity is persistently present in the vicinity of some adjacent planets in our solar system, but this remote region remains unknown. Exploration is innate to humans, and some contend it is our duty. However, most of these proposed landing missions have yet to be rejected in preference of missions to Jupiter and Saturn to investigate the habitability of their numerous moons. Despite some hypothetical missions, the Triton mission must pass the proposal phase. One such proposed mission is the Triton Hopper, a small craft that would descend on the moon's surface, harvest its nitrogen ice, and use it as rocket fuel. The next NASA Discovery mission, Trident, will be a transit mission to the Moon. Some have hypothesized that Triton has a subsurface ocean, which this flyby would ascertain. As soon as such an ocean is discovered, we can seriously discuss the Moon's habitability. Even this far from the Sun's life-giving warmth, it is inconceivable that basic life could exist beneath the surface of this geologically active marvel. Triton's surface presumably contains organic compounds. Despite this, the conversation about habitability should not be premature. Methods for reaching the moon have yet to be established. As we examine moons more closely, we may discover they possess unique characteristics and possibilities that make them habitable. Triton is one of several solar system moons with the potential to reawaken life. We are beginning to comprehend the history of Triton, a tiny enslaved planet that orbits a mysterious planet. With missions to Mars and Venus, it's easy to forget how enthralling this region of the solar system is. Who knows what fascinating revelations we may uncover in its darkness?